Hello, I am Orna Kupferman from the Hebrew University, and this is going to be a short course on automata on infinite rows. And I assume you know something about automata on finite rows, and you know that every automaton defines a language of finite words, so it's a subset of sigma star, and the type of languages are things like I can define an automaton for the language of all words W such that the length of W is even. Or I can define another automaton for the language of all words W such that W contains 0, 0, 1 in it. Yeah, so these are automata on finite words. They run on a word. If they end up in an accepting state, then the word is in the language. If not, it is not. And now we want to talk about automata on infinite words. So the languages are subsets of sigma omega. Omega, the first ordinal, the words are infinite. Some properties are no longer relevant. For example, it's not interesting to talk about the length of a word being even because the length of a word is always infinite. Some properties are interesting. I can still talk about an infinite word containing or not containing some substring. Before we define them and see what we do with them, let's ask why do we want to talk about infinite words? And there are several answers. First, people started to look at automata on infinite words, and that was in the 60s, Gluck did it, because they wanted to reason about the natural numbers. The natural numbers So unlike truth values, where we have only two truth values, if we want to reason about theories about the natural numbers, and there are infinitely many of them, and they are even ordered, then reasoning about natural numbers has the flavor of reasoning about some infinite linear sequence. So that was one motivation. Then in the 80s, people became more practical and wanted to reason about ongoing behavior. Of non-terminating systems. Non-terminating systems. What do I mean by that? So imagine you have a computerized system. This system interacts with an environment, so it gets inputs and it generates output. Think about an ATM, a vending machine, an operating system, a missile. Yeah, and these systems, when you want to reason about their properties, it's not that we care about things like the system finds, let's say, the GCD of two numbers. This is a finite process. It has the thing we want to reason about is relation between the input and the output after a finite process. But if we care about the ongoing behavior of non-terminating systems, then we care about what happens in the middle. We care about things like whenever I press the button is pressed, then something happens eventually. Then eventually something, the job is printed, something happens. And here I do not refer to a process that terminates, but I want to know what happens in the middle inside this interaction of the system with its environment. I can specify this. I may want to specify that, for example, infinitely often. There is green light. So these are properties that I cannot specify as finite words. I also cannot specify as relations between input and output of at a certain point in time, but rather as an infinite process. And I want to refer to things that happen during it, the ongoing behavior of non-terminating systems. And another motivation that is true always, and is still true, this is simply a beautiful theory, a beautiful mathematical combinatorial theory with many interesting and still open issues. So let's see what are these beautiful automata on infinite worlds. Here is an automaton. So it has an initial state, let's call it Q0, and like automata on finite worlds, we have an alphabet. In this example, the alphabet will be 0, 1. And let's assume that this automaton, whenever it sees zero, it goes here to this state, Q1. Whenever it sees one, it goes back to Q0. And this state is accepting. And we drew it the same way we draw automata on finite worlds. So if we view this automaton A as an automaton on finite worlds, so if we now care about finite worlds, then you probably know that this automaton, since it goes to an accepting state whenever it sees a zero, the language of this automaton, the set of words it accepts, are all words that end with a zero. And we even have a regular expression for it, all words that end with a zero. But now we want this automaton to run on infinite words. So suddenly this automaton gets an infinite sequence of zeros and ones. So the run need not terminate, it does not terminate. And still we want to define when a word is in the language of this automaton and when it is not. So how do we do it? Intuitively, we are going to say that the word is in the language if a run of the automaton, and this is a deterministic automaton, the one I drew here, it has a single run on each word. If it visits the set of accepting states infinitely often, we are going to define it formally. Just for this example, yes, since the automaton, whenever it sees a zero, it goes to the accepting state Q1, then I know that after every visit, after every zero, I will have a visit in Q1. So this automaton is going to visit Q1 infinitely often, if and only if there are infinitely many zeros in the world. So this is the general idea, but we are going to formalize it and see exactly how we define languages. So let's do it. So an automaton, if we want to define it formally, and we want, so A is a tuple. It has a set of letters, the alphabet, a set of states, a set of initial states, a transition function, and an acceptance condition. So the new thing here is going to be the acceptance condition, but just to be complete, let's say that, yes, that Q0, a subset of Q, is the set of initial states. This automaton, the definition, we are going to define a non-deterministic automaton, so this set need not be a singleton set, and the transition function delta takes a state and a letter and map it to the set of successor states, which need not be a singleton. If the automaton is deterministic, then we have a single initial state and the transition function maps a state and the letter to a single state. So this is as in automata on finite worlds, alpha is in acceptance conditions, and we are going to see several acceptance conditions. And these acceptance conditions are going to tell us when a run, which will be a sequence of words, is good or not, whether it is accepting or not accepting. So this is an automaton. What is a run of this automaton? A run of this automaton, so first a run of A, we are talking on a run on a word W, and let's say that the first letter is W1, then W2, W3, and so on. This is an infinite word, so it's an infinite sequence of letters. So what is it? It's a function R. I can define it also as a sequence of states. I prefer to define it as a function that tells me for each location in which state I am. So what does this function should satisfy? The run should start in the initial state, in any initial state. So R of zero is in Q zero. And the run should respect the transition function. So for every I greater than zero, we know that R of I plus one should be a member of R I with the letter that comes now, and this will be W I plus one, right? Because we started with W one. So for example, R of one should be in the, what the transition function takes me to when I'm in R of zero, an initial state, and the first letter. So I'm getting such a function, and if you want, sometimes we refer to R also as a sequence, Q0, Q1, Q2, and so on. And when we say QI, it is simply R of I. Yeah, so we can view runs both as a function from the natural number to the states and as an infinite sequence of states. So this is in Q omega, an infinite sequence of states. And now we want to define when a run is accepting, when it satisfies the acceptance condition. When the run is on a finite words, it's clear. When a run has a final state, then I want the final state to be a member of the set of accepting states. When the run is infinite, two things are not clear. One thing is how the automaton runs. So we are not going to bother about it. If you are worried about how an automaton can run on an infinite world and the run does not terminate, then you can think of it as if the automaton, whenever it takes a step, then the next step, it does it as faster. It takes half of the time to take the next transition. Yeah, so from Q0 to Q1, 1 second, from Q1 to Q2, half a second, from Q2 to Q3, only a quarter of a second, and then after 2 seconds, the automaton is done. But we're not going to bother about it because essentially, eventually is going, everything is going to boil down to the finite structure of the automaton. So the run is indeed infinite, but we can still reason about it. So this is a run, and now we want to define acceptance. So acceptance. And as I said, there are several acceptance conditions. We are going to start with Bucci automata. In Bucci automata, the acceptance condition alpha is a subset of the states. So this is exactly like automata on finite worlds. And a run is accepting, R is accepting if it visits alpha infinitely often. So assume that whenever the run visits the states in alpha, a red or a green light is turned on, a run is accepting if we have infinitely many green lights. Formally, we are going to define inf of R. Inf of R is a subset of the states, and this is the set of states Q such that R visits Q infinitely often. We are going to use this infinitely often shortcut formally. Yes, it means that there are exists there R infinitely many I's such that R of I is Q, and a run is accepting, R is accepting if inf of R, its intersection with alpha, is not empty. So there is a state in the set of accepting states in alpha that was visited infinitely often. And since the state space is finite, Q is finite, and the run is infinite, I know that inf of R is not going to be empty. This is guaranteed. So I want the set of states that are visited infinitely often by R to include at least one state in alpha. So this is the formal definition of when a run of a Bucci automaton is accepting. And now the language of an automaton A is the set of all words W such that there is an accepting run of A on W. This is just like automata on finite words. The automaton may be non-deterministic. It may have several runs. I only need one of them to be accepting. Of course, if it's a deterministic automaton, then I could say that the run of A on W is accepting. And we are going to say that a language L is omega regular if and only if there is a non-deterministic Bucci word automaton. So this is an acronym we are going to use, NBW, non-deterministic Bucci word automaton, A, such that L of A is L. And as in automata on finite words, we want to know whether all languages are omega regular, other properties of them, and what we can do with it. First, let's see some examples. So we already saw this automaton in the context of finite words. Let's now see it again. Whenever I have zero, I go to Q1. Whenever I see one, I go to Q0. This is my initial state. And we said that this state is accepting. So if I want to define it as a tuple, I'm not going to really do it, but you can see, I guess, that this figure, I can describe it also with sigma is 0, 1, and the set of states is Q0. And Q1 and Q0 includes only the state Q0 and delta and so on. So delta of Q0 with 1 is Q0. I'm not going to write everything. Alpha is Q1. So this is the tuple that represents this automaton. And what is the language of this automaton? We said whenever I see 0, I go to Q1. So the language of A, when I view it as a Bucci automaton, are all words W, such that W includes infinitely many zeros. And the same way we have regular expressions, we also have omega regular expressions. I can also define this language as I want infinitely many zeros. So I want infinitely many segments ending with a zero. So this is an omega regular expression that defines the set of all words with infinitely many zeros. So this is our first example, easy example. Let's see a more involved example. Let's try to draw an automaton for all words W. So this will be our L2. Oops. So L2, I want all words W such that W has a finite even number of zeros or infinitely many zeros. So let's understand what's going on in this language. Yeah? So if the number of zeros is finite, then it has to be even. So for example, the word 0, 1, 0, 1 omega. 1 omega means there is an infinite tail of ones. It belongs to the language, right? Because it has a finite even number of zeros. If I look at the word 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, yes, which is 0, 1 omega, this is also in the language. Why? Because I have infinitely many zeros. But the word 0, 1 omega is not in the language because it has only finitely many zeros, an odd number of zeros. So think about an automaton for this language. How will it look like? So let's draw it. So I am going to have two states. This state, the initial state, is where I'm going to be after reading an even number of zeros. So this is our state for an even number of zeros so far, which means that in this state, if I see a one, I do not change my status. If I see a zero, I will move to another state. This will be my state for an odd number of zeros so far. And I'm going to switch between these two states when I see a zero, because then the parity of the zero changes. If I see one, the parity does not change, and I'm allowed to get stuck here. I'm allowed to get stuck here because if I am in this state, let's call it Q0, then I've read so far an even number of zeros, and if I now read an infinite tail of ones, I'm okay. I will visit Q0 infinitely often. I will get stuck in Q0. And luckily, it is also the case that if I visit infinitely many zeros, then I will visit this state Q0 infinitely often. So this automaton, and it's a good way to make sure you see that it really does the job, it accepts a word if and only if it has infinitely many zeros, because then it will circle here infinitely often and will visit Q0 infinitely often. And it also accepts words that have a finite number of zeros, a finite but even, because then these words will end up in Q0 forever. So this is our automaton for the language L2. Now, let's do two more examples, but I will make a break in the recording so you can draw them yourself. So the language is actually going to be the same. Our L3 is going to be all words W, such that if I have infinitely many zeros in W, then I also have infinitely many ones in zero. But I want you to draw two automata. One is for the case the alphabet is only 0 and 1, and one, so this will be sigma 1, is one is for the case where we have 3 letters, 0, 1, and 2. So we will make a short break, and after it, during the break, you will draw two automata, both for this language, all words such that if there are infinitely many zeros, then there are infinitely many ones. So for example, I don't want to see in L3 the word O omega, right? Because in O omega, I have infinitely many zeros and only finitely many, in fact, zero occurrences of Y. I don't want to see 2, 1 omega for the same reason. So this word also does not appear in L3, and we want to see two automata, one for the case the alphabet is 0, 1, and one for the case the alphabet is 0, 1, and 2.